These are basically groups that take money from one or multiple billionaires and foundations, bundle it together, and then pass it along to other activist groups. In his case, he's basically been bankrolling the environmental left for decades. And so here are just examples of people who live in a very quiet, shadowy world that rarely make public appearances and yet are shaping our politics. They don't want to show where this agenda leads because they know that if they tried to sell it as socialism, most people would reject it. Mm-hmm. So they cover it up, they call it other things, or they just simply hide it in the shadows. It's like money laundering in the sense that it washes away all the ties to the original donor. So there's a huge advantage for a foundation whose funders, Bill and Melinda Gates, don't want to be seen as political, using a political pass-through that basically hides their giving to outright partisan, sometimes radical left causes. Joyful, joyful Lord, we adore thee, God of glory,
Lord of God. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an interfaith international coalition to defend the family. Marriage, family, human sexuality, all these issues are in a state of confusion and chaos. At the Ruth Institute, we bring you solid scientific information to help you make sense of a world that's lost its mind. So welcome back to reality. People sometimes ask me, where did all this come from? Gay marriage, transgenderism, it seems like it came out of nowhere so fast. Well, my guest today can help us with that. My guest today is Mr. Hayden Ludwig, who works for the Capital Research Center. This organization tracks the influence money, foundations that are supposedly charitable, but which are really propaganda organizations. So as you're getting settled into the world of common sense and sound thinking, be sure to hit that subscribe button below and hit the little bell to get notifications of our newest uploads. We upload new videos twice a week. And do keep your finger on that share button because you're going to want to share this video with your friends and family. Today, we're going to take a look at the infrastructure of the sexual revolution. Who are all these people and how are they getting these things done? Hayden Ludwig, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Hi, it's good to be with you, Dr. Morris. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Great. So tell us a little bit about the Capital Research Center and its mission. I wasn't familiar with it until a mutual friend introduced us.
Yeah, we've actually been around since the early 1980s, but we really only came on most people's radar in the last few years. Got a new staff, new leadership, and we've really kind of turned a corner from our sleepy older days long before me and my colleagues were there. We basically are America's investigative think tank. We follow, you kind of described the foundation money. We follow the funding from big mega donors on the left, big foundations to these outer circles of activist groups and litigation nonprofits and environmentalist groups and labor unions, that sort of thing, that kind of surround the two parties so that when most people think about how politics works, they think about the Republican and Democratic parties. But in reality, there are billions of dollars, tens of billions of dollars in professional activist groups that form kind of an outer ring to pressure lawmakers into passing legislation. And very few organizations study this. We're one of the very few.
Well, I'm glad to know you guys are out there. And I know that a lot of my followers are going to be glad to know that you guys are out there. A friend of mine put it on the radar screen how much George Soros in particular was doing. And when I had a particular question in my mind, she's always the person that I call, and she's the one who pointed me to you. So what you're working on is much bigger than one man and his contributions from the sounds of it.
Yeah, most people have heard of George Soros, and for a good reason. I mean, he spends billions of dollars basically funding the professional left.
Right.
He's got his hands in just about everything. It's a great story. But what most people aren't aware of is George Soros is just one mega donor. There are hundreds such mega donors commanding billions of dollars between them. That's just the big donors. There are thousands of foundations, many, many thousands of activist groups that spin off these foundations. So when we study the left, we study Soros, but we also study the groups you've never heard of. I'll give you an example of one that came onto most people's radar in 2020. That's Tom Steyer out of California. Tom Steyer ran for president in the Democratic Party primary in mid-2020, didn't do very well. But he was a big environmentalist guy in that primary. Well, we had known about him because we've been following him for years. Steyer funds single-handedly dozens of major pass-through environmental groups. These are basically groups that take money from one or multiple billionaires and foundations, bundle it together, and then pass it along to other activist groups. In his case, he's basically been bankrolling the environmental left for decades. And so here are just examples of people who live in a very quiet, shadowy world that rarely make public appearances and yet are shaping our politics.
Well, you know, the other person that people have now heard a lot about is Bill Gates. Because of the very recent things, that the subject which we shall not name because it will bring down the bots on us and so on. But I think everyone knows what I'm talking about when you mention Bill Gates. There are lots of different things that he's financing that support an overall program, which unless you look at the pieces all together, you go, well, you know, why, you know? But after a while, you can sort of go, that has the smell of a Bill Gates organization. They're kind of all on the same template a little bit, but not exactly. So when you say bundle, you use this term bundling. When you say that this man passes through money through organizations that they bundle with others, what's the point of that? Why are they doing that? Why not just hand it out directly?
It's obfuscation. It's deception. It's one of the lessons I've learned studying the left over these past number of years is that the left rarely has a popular agenda.
Say that again. Wait a minute. Say that again. I just love hearing that. Say it again.
Well, occasionally they get somebody like Barack Obama who can really ride the waves and get a popular appeal. But for the most part, its agenda is not popular. It's
right.
So especially now when we're living at a time when the left is basically rearing its socialist head, this is really where the far left is driving the train of the rest of the less far left, you could say. And what we're seeing is they don't want to show where this agenda leads because they know that if they tried to sell it as socialism, most people would reject it. Mm-hmm. So they cover it up, they call it other things, or they just simply hide it in the shadows. So I'll give you an example of a group that I've spent a lot of time, last 2 years actually, studying. That's a prime example of this bundling tactic. That's an organization called Arabella Advisors. And Arabella, some people may have heard of that now. It came on the radar after we started reporting on it about 2 years ago. This is an organization. It's a for-profit consulting company here in Washington. This is a for-profit company that controls a collection of nonprofits, each of which has leadership from this for-profit company. So this network of nonprofits is huge. In 2019 alone, it commanded $731 million. That's just 1 year. It's been around for 15, 16 years, this network. So you can imagine it's spent something like $3 billion, $3.5 billion over the last decade and a half. That was in total obscurity until we exposed it a couple of years ago. So you think, well, what's the point? What does it do? Well, a lot of the donors to these nonprofits are big foundations. Actually, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is the single biggest donor I know of to Arabella Advisors. It gives hundreds of millions of dollars every year to Arabella's groups. Well, what that money does is that money goes into this network of 501c3 nonprofits, which then in turn, they funnel it out to other activist groups so that when I trace that funding to, let's just say, like MoveOn.org or the Sierra Club or one of these groups that we've maybe heard of, I can't tell you the original donor because it's going through this pass-through that obscures and it kind of, it's like money laundering in the sense that it washes away all the ties to the original donor. So there's a huge advantage for a foundation whose funders, Bill and Melinda Gates, don't want to be seen as political, using a political pass-through that basically hides their giving to outright partisan, sometimes radical left causes.
Wow. Now, the thing that got me interested in looking for you was a particular thing that is going on in the pro-life side and the Catholic side of things. So, and I know you guys are not particularly focused on social issues. You're focused on the whole, kind of the whole range of conservative issues. But I think you know something about this topic. And that is the concerted effort of some of these big donors to undermine the teachings of the churches, to undermine traditional religion, traditional religious values, and so on. And so the incident that popped up on my radar screen is the head of the U.S. Catholic Bishops Pro-Life Committee is Archbishop Joseph Naumann from Kansas City, Kansas. He's a really good guy. He's a solid, rock solid guy. And he has said, you know, President Biden, you're calling yourself a devout Catholic, but you really should make clear that what you advocate is not Catholic. And for this, for his trouble, he got a bunch of left-wing so-called Catholics who got up a petition against him to say that he should be dismissed from his position as chairman of the pro-life secretariat and so on. So, you know, the usual leftist pressure, whatever. But what caught my, and so, you know, I didn't pay too much attention to it, but what caught my eye is that when I clicked through to see who is this. Well, there were a couple of organizations. It wasn't just like a random guy who got up a petition, you know, a nice grassroots guy trying to influence the public debate all by himself. No, there are a couple of organizations in the background, and I just went, Soros. I wonder who these people are. So what the two groups were, Faith and Public Life Action was one of them, and one of them was called Faithful America. Do you know anything about these groups?
Yeah, I sure do.
Oh, tell us about them. People are going to be interested.
Before I do, so one of the key things about studying the left is the appeal is always to look like you've got grassroots support. You've got this tidal wave of popular support behind whatever you're doing. It doesn't even matter the issue. But that's really hard to get when you're basically pushing radicalism, socialism, whatever, unpopular things. So they fake it. So what these two groups are a great example of, basically faking grassroots support by ginning up a lot of signatures from, who knows, maybe they're genuine, maybe they're not, you can't ever find out, from sending a lot of mass form letters to congressmen's offices, doing a lot of email blasts. All that is very easily done from just a couple offices in Washington, D.C., but you can make it look like this tidal wave coming from everywhere, from across the entire country. So both of those groups actually have an interesting background. They were both spawned by professional groups just down the street from my office here in Washington. So Faith and Public Life, I believe what came out of the center, CEL, the Civic Engagement Lab, which should sound kind of Soviet because it is.
It does. Yeah, it sounds like 1930s progressivism or something.
It does. Yeah.
Is it like a concrete building or something? I mean, you know, it just has that whole feel.
Well, it's a Soros-funded organization that does exactly what it sounds like. Lab. It thinks up new ideas. It's a think tank for promoting civic engagement. When you hear that term, civic engagement, that should tell you basically getting out votes for Democratic or just simply liberal politicians. And the thing is, you know, these groups operate as nonprofits that are technically nonpartisan in the sense they don't advocate directly for a political party, but they're totally ideological and they're funded to do this. And this is kind of the point I made earlier, is there's a huge just networks of organizations that while they're not technically nonpartisan, because you're not allowed to be a nonprofit that's nonpartisan by law, they basically support the political parties by forming this ring around them so that they may as well effectively be partisan. So when they do civic engagement, that basically means turning out votes in places where liberal politicians running for public office need those votes. So in this case, you have Faith and Public Life, which was spawned by the CEL, and it exists basically to act like it's a both an evangelical Protestant and Roman Catholic group. It's a concerned citizens group, but in reality, it's just highly paid professional activists. And all they do is they run attack campaigns against legitimate things. And they kind of rely, this is my theory, but they kind of rely on people not knowing who they are, not knowing that these things are fake, and being fooled, being deceived into thinking, oh, wow, they say that they have 51,000 signatures from concerned Christians across America, so they must be genuine. Yeah, but really? Do they, though? I mean, there's been times when we've been able to find out, no, that's a bunch of garbage. They don't have that at all.
Is that right? So you actually found out that their list of signatures was somehow bogus or generated by bots or something? No, or what do you mean?
I know the model that they use, and the model has been discovered to be fraudulent. I can't follow every poll that they do.
Yeah,
but the
okay.
model for Faithful America is what I'm thinking of. Faithful America was created by the Center for American Progress.
Oh, those nice people. Oh, yeah.
If you know the Heritage Foundation, it's the heritage of the left, basically. It's their mm-hmm. principal think tank. It's as left-wing as they come. Mm-hmm. It is not friendly to Christianity. It is not friendly to religion of any kind. It's very secular, very atheist.
Right.
Militantly so. And Faithful America was basically their way to create a version of MoveOn.org. Now, some people may have heard of MoveOn. It's basically what I'm talking about. It creates fake grassroots campaigns. It's a website that has a bunch of paid activists. And what they do is they gin up signatures that they then send to senators and congressmen in the White House to try and say, hey, you know, the people really feel strongly about, you know, open borders. So therefore, you need to get rid of the wall or whatever, right? They target any number of issues. Faithful America was a way to basically do that in the religious sphere, to take evangelicals and Roman Catholics and fool them into thinking, wow, I guess, you know, I had no idea that this cardinal was such an awful guy. So, you know, I must not support him. But it's all fake, right?
Mm-hmm.
And deception. It's really militant leftists, very few of whom would ever call themselves Christian of any flavor. Most of them very much opposed to organized religion. And yet they're trying to pass this off as like the voice of the Christian people in the United States.
Right. And it's a little bit different from the partisan things you were mentioning earlier, because what they're doing is going after kind of foundational issues. The cultural sphere, the cultural, what do we want to call it? Like the cultural air that everybody's breathing, to try to get that polluted with leftist premises, so that you can't think clearly or that your mind is automatically tilted in a certain direction and so on. So going after Archbishop Naumann, I consider something of that sort, because, you know, really the Congress doesn't really care who's in charge of the Bishop's Pro-Life Committee. You know, this is just a guy out there making Biden look bad. Biden's our guy. We got to do something about it. You know, that's kind of the way I interpreted it. But I wouldn't be surprised if they're not up to something much worse, you know, that they could initiate campaigns against college presidents or, you know, speakers, or get people canceled. You know, I mean, this was an attempt to cancel this guy. I mean, not from his main post. You know, they're not going to run him out of Kansas City. But, you know, it was an attempt at a cancel culture kind of thing, which is potentially...
Right. I mean, it's discrediting him. So the goal is not really to change the minds of conservative Christians. The goal is really to say, the figures that you follow, that you support, that you take seriously, that you shouldn't.
Right.
We're going to run smear campaigns against them. It's really what it is. It's just dirty politics. Everything that everybody hates about politics, this is the kind of stuff that they do as their bread and butter. And I noticed that, you know, these groups, they're not interested in convincing you that their ideas are sound or changing public opinion on whatever issue. It doesn't even really matter. They're much more interested in deceiving you into following something that if it was presented to you, they never would. The issue I keep thinking of is environmentalism. I spent a lot of time studying global warming theory and the groups that support it. And there's a huge number of groups like this, and actually Faithful America and Faith in Public Life are two of them, that try to pretend that global warming theory, that is that humans are destroying the planet, one day we're going to kill everything, including ourselves, because we're not driving Priuses and we're burning coal, that's somehow a biblical concept, when of course it's not. It's actually very, very opposed to the biblical worldview. And the people who push it are also opposed to the biblical worldview. And if you follow their funders, they're also opposed to this. So it's the model I like to think of is kind of an upside down pyramid, if you will. You think a pyramid, it's got a large base and it's got a small point. Well, you flip that upside down and you have a huge base resting on one point, one lie. And mm-hmm. when they create these lies, they can build a huge superstructure on top of this one lie. And so my strategy has always been go for the lie. If you can tear that part down, everything above it collapses and you're left with the rubble.
Mm-hmm. So it turns out that there are two other organizations that have counter petitions to defend Archbishop Naumann, And both of these two counter petitions have more signatures than Faithful Americas. So I think those are probably real numbers. I think those are probably Catholic Vote has one, and LifeSiteNews has a petition to, you know, to say, hey, Padre, we love what you're doing. Hang in there, you know, a kind of a thing. So now, you know, you use the term smear campaign, which really interests me because recently I interviewed a law professor named Ron Rychlak, who I don't know if you're familiar with him, but he is an expert on disinformation. He wrote a book called Disinformation. He co-authored it with the guy who was a who had been like one of the top generals in Romania under Ceausescu, and the guy defected. And so with this, you know, highest ranking Soviet defector, basically Soviet bloc defector, Ron and this guy wrote a book explaining how disinformation works, you know, and it's more subtle than blatant propaganda, but it's a smear campaign. And the thing he was most familiar with is the smear campaign against Pius XII, saying that Pius XII was really Hitler's Pope and he did nothing to help the Jews and so on and so forth, which, you know, Dr. Rychlak is like, wait a minute, he was a hero during his lifetime. How did that happen so fast that all of a sudden everybody's saying, talking smack about him? Well, he looked into it, and of course it was all made up, you know, and he could trace how it was made up. And so the disinformation process, I just think it's something people need to be more aware of in general. Don't you think, Hayden?
Yeah, and the other aspect of this, another related tactic is misdirection. Right?
Yes.
You simply give, you throw them off. And you notice these words could be easily applied to the intelligence realm or to war, military stuff. It's because they've learned a lot of tactics, I think, studying. It's the relationship of politics and basically warfare, right? Mm-hmm. Things are connected at the hip. And it's amazing if you go back, the Soviets are a great example. If you go back to the 1917 revolution, you'd find that Lenin and his ilk were masters at doing this sort of thing. I mean, the very term Bolshevik, right, meaning majority, well, they weren't the majority. They were actually Mensheviks, the minority, but you choose clever names like that. I mean, Hitler did it the same thing in the 1920s, 1930s. One of the things I've studied is the origins of modern environmentalism as a movement and how I've discovered it's actually the sibling to the pro-abortion movement because they have a common ancestor. Which seems a little strange to most people. It's not intuitive, but if you follow it back to its origins, you can trace it back to Margaret Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, who had a whole coalition of people who supported eugenics, right? Crazy ideas like phrenology, studying skull shapes to determine your intelligence, and all sorts of wild ideas. And of course, the socialist movement of the early 20th century. And these things have in common basically a misanthropic view, an anti-human view of the world. Their anthropology is that human beings are evil, fundamentally evil, not sinful, not fallen, evil, and that we are a plague on the world. And if you follow the development of that idea, it leads you basically into modern global warming activism, and it also leads you into the pro-abortion left. It's very interesting. So we're dealing with people who've been developing these ideas for well over a century, and they've learned tactics from the Soviets. They've studied these things, perfected them. So, I mean, just the development of the modern activist left and its networking since the 1970s is stunning. How it used to be, if you go back to the 60s and early 70s, it was the hippies who were not organized. They had no real funding behind them. They dropped out of the culture. But then in the 1970s, they dropped back into the culture. They started becoming professors, getting their PhDs, they started going into business. This is the origins of everything we see today. I mean, I've traced it back to the 70s. And it's when they finally figured out, guys, if we don't start politically organizing, kind of like the Soviets did, 60 years before then, we're never going to get our way. We're never going to defeat the conservatives. And since then, they have learned those lessons, and it's stunning to see the results.
Well, and part of it is that the big donor class, whoever they were in the 1970s, those people, the equivalent of Soros and Gates at that time, they picked out certain elements in the hippie movement to finance. You know, there were certain aspects of it that served their purposes and certain things that didn't. And so what interests me about what you said, and I know a lot of our listeners are, you know, are tuned in to the whole idea of population control, and that's what these things have in common as well, that zero population growth is an environmental goal, you know, and zero population growth or population control is a eugenics goal to improve the population and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. At some point in the 70s, in fact, 1974, John D. Rockefeller III figured out that openly talking about population control wasn't working. And he started talking about feminism. He started talking about women's empowerment. Because if you could just get the women to go to college and you could just frame all this stuff in terms of women having jobs and college, they'd have fewer kids. You wouldn't have to push them, you know, because there were a lot, there was a lot of feminist pushback to population control because they saw women didn't want the pill. Women didn't want the side effects. Women didn't want abortion. They didn't want to kill their own babies, you know? And so only certain people got to be called feminists, right? Those ladies are no longer feminists anymore. You know, those ladies, we don't even know who those ladies are, right? But they were there. And so at some point, certain people got the push and got to be promoted as the true authentic voice of females, you know?
I totally agree. Two things. I mean, you can see that today with the United Nations has a Gates Foundation funded program called Family Planning 2020.
Uh-huh.
It was their big marker. And it's basically half abortion and half education for women. And yeah, they can they see it clear as day. I mean, it's really helpful with things like this to follow. What is their goal? What are they seeing? What's in their mind? And you can follow it to the logical conclusion, basically see, predict what they're going to do next.
But getting back to these fake faith groups, okay, because they're wreaking havoc in a number of the denominations from what I can understand. So can you tell people a little bit more about Faithful America? Who do we know specifically who funds them? I mean, I realize they're part of this network, but do you know anything specifically about who funds these outfits?
Yeah, a lot of the number, there's similar funders between Faith in Public Life and Faithful America. The biggest ones are the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. Hewlett is in Hewlett Packard, the mm-hmm. PC company. This is a big Silicon Valley foundation that is, it's big and basically in both population / abortion issues and environmentalism. It's it funds a series of groups called the Eco Right, that's my name for them. It's basically groups that are pro-global warming that try to rebrand global warming as a conservative issue, as a free market issue. It's like the secular equivalent of something like this, right? Where it's just not a religious organization, but it's the same goals. That's the Hewlett Foundation. Next to the Hewlett Foundation is another one called the Energy Foundation. This is like the ultimate environmentalist pass-through, also based in the San Francisco Bay Area. The Energy Foundation was set up some years ago by the Hewlett Foundation and a number of other left-wing foundations. And basically, it's a bundler. So what it does is it takes money from these big foundations, it takes it, absorbs all that, and then it passes that money along to other activists. And the advantage is twofold. It hides the original foundation donor so that I could never connect, say, this dollar, I can't trace it from this foundation all the way to this activist group pushing this agenda. That's one thing. But the other thing too is, even though it's called the foundation, the Energy Foundation is actually not a foundation. It's a different kind of nonprofit, just a regular 501c3. They're allowed to do some limited amount of lobbying and they can support other lobbying groups. So this is a way for foundations, which can't do any of that, to bypass a lot of the IRS restrictions. And that's what bundling allows them to do. Now, I don't think they're breaking any laws. I've never caught them doing that. But it's a way to bypass, you know, the very carefully written rules that basically say foundations are there to do philanthropy, you know, to provide charitable work, not to change public policy. So the left is very good at these kinds of avoidance mechanisms, setting up groups that allow, it makes it just difficult to even trace.
The import of that is that these are tax exempt, able to, they have favorable tax status, let's put it that way, because mm-hmm. they are a foundation, but they're funneling it through this series of who knows what exactly, and it comes out the other end doing mm-hmm. things which would not be permitted ordinarily to the kind of organization that originally gave the money. Is that what it amounts to?
Yeah, that's a very common tactic we found, although we rarely catch them in the act. And it sounds illegal, it's not. It's actually just being very clever. I mean, this right. is the way the rules are written. It's vague enough that any expensive lawyer could find a way to basically allow you to fund whatever you want to fund if you've got the money to do it.
Right.
We found, actually, I found documents on a different issue that I'll just tell you, I found a document for a left-wing foundation, which is barred from doing advocacy work, cannot fund advocacy groups directly, and yet would hire a consulting firm to come in and basically say, well, we'll take all this money from you, we'll move it into this other group that we'll set up, and then that other group will do all of the lobbying, and nobody will know it's connected, but they'll privately be advised by you, they'll privately send quarterly reports updating your board of what's going on, and the way you move the money is you use a third party to obscure that money flow. That stuff happens all the time. We just rarely get to see it because they're too smart to put it out in the open most of the time.
So if I could go back to faith in action and faith in public life and these type of organization, the Hewlett Foundation is doing something like that to channel money to they're giving money directly from the Hewlett Foundation to these guys. And then there's a bundling outfit that is also controlled by Hewlett. Is that right?
It's not controlled by Hewlett, but it's a different setup so that you have money flows coming from half a dozen directions instead of just two donors. Okay. And what they're allowed to do with that, they're very smart. These two groups, Faithful America, Faith in Public Action, Faith in Public Life. The action arm, by the way, is the 501c4.
Four, right. If action's on the end, that means you're allowed to go to the state legislature. Right.
Without boring people, basically the difference between a 501c3 and a c4 is how much money you're allowed to spend on lobbying.
That's really right.
And the IRA controls money flows between groups like that so that they can't be too obvious about it. But basically, yeah, they take advantage of this whole really complicated system of nonprofit organizations, which where does that even come from? That was set up to do genuine charitable work, to feed the poor and to provide libraries and public facilities and things like that the government doesn't allow. And that's what's so tragic about it. We have billions of dollars caught up in the nonprofit sector because this goes back to the American character of 1776 that we do as private citizens what we don't want the government to do. We form committees and stuff like that to do it ourselves. Well, the left has taken that and they've weaponized it so that they can do politics and call it philanthropy. And they do. Gates will call himself a great philanthropist. Meanwhile, he's probably one of the largest donors to pro-abortion causes trying to change loosen abortion policies in overseas poor countries.
And one of the things that's really appalling about that is, among the many things that are appalling, is that if they would just spend that money to solve the problems, you could solve a lot of problems, but they spend that money to change people's way of thinking and to change the government under which everybody's operating. They're trying to change the laws in other countries. You could give everybody a new pair of shoes. You could give everybody nicer houses. You could do all sorts of things with that money, but instead you're telling them to make abortion legal, and which they don't want to do. It's really, that's why I find that just hard to take.
Imperialism too, the kind of a colonialism that the left always complains about.
Oh yeah. We talk, we have other times here at the Ruth Institute where we've talked about cultural colonialism quite a bit, and ideological imperialism, that's what we call it. And our friends in Africa, we've said to them, listen, you guys use these terms. It'll drive American leftists crazy. It will help you. Call them colonialists. So are there any comparable networks on the right? I don't know of anybody on the social conservative side doing this type of stuff. There's nobody like Bill Gates on my side, but there might be somebody like Bill Gates on some other so-called conservative issue. I don't know. What's the comparable picture on the right?
It's interesting. Most people think of just the parties as mirror opposites or the political right and left as mirror. They're not. It's very asymmetric. You're right. I mean, there is no comparable network. There are major foundations. There are major donors. I mean, my own organization has some of those major conservative donors, right? But they don't network the same way. And I think it has to do with the mentality. I mean, if you look at the way the conservative right is organized, it's basically conservatives tend to bow out of the political discussion until we sense there's a crisis. And then we have a Braveheart moment where we come charging in with muskets and swords and we go to the polls and we vote and then we go home. But that's not how the left operates. Right. The left is in a perpetual state of revolution. So if you think about it, that's why they came up with the term community organizing. It's basically a way to brand what they do. So I think one of the ways it's interesting to consider how the left thinks, right? You have to understand how Marxists think, right? Marxists don't think in terms of elections. They're not really even little r Republicans or little d Democrats. They're not interested in a democratic system of government, in other words. They're interested in power. And power can take generations to acquire. That big revolution that they always talk about, that can take many generations to come. In fact, the progressive movement is a work in progress going back at least 115, 120 years. We're just starting to see the real fruits of that now. But they have to think in terms of generation, because when you have to work on the periphery and lie to people and deceive people because you know they wouldn't support what you want if you ask them to vote on it, that's going to take decades to accomplish. So that means you have to have whole networks of groups that are ideologically sound, ideologically consistent. I mean, it's fascinating. If you look at the way like the Soviets operated, they had a whole class of officers in the Red Army, commissars, whose entire job was simply to make sure that the troops were doctrinally pure. They were all very good Marxists. That's it. That was entirely how they saw the world. It's the same thing, but just translated to activism. Take away the weapons. They think the same way. So conservatives, you know, I think part of the problem is we're discovering right now, especially after the 2020 election, some of the stuff we saw come out of that with mm-hmm. voting irregularities, we're discovering that if we want to save our country, we have to be always tuned in. We can't afford to just wait every 2 to 4 years to show up at the polls, vote the right way, and expect everything's going to turn out the right way.
Right, right.
The left doesn't do that. The left has decades where they basically work on flipping courts, with decades where they work on pressuring groups to pass immigration reform, right, or Obamacare. This is one of them. And we don't think like that. And so right. Part of my job is learning from our opponents. How do they see the world, and what can we do to counter that?
Right, right. That's very interesting. It's a long-term psychological warfare. You know, in addition to the electoral warfare, there's the psychological warfare that drives people off the field. You know, if you can make people feel demoralized and discouraged, then they won't even show up to play, and then therefore you win by default. It's astonishing to me how much we've lost by default, by nobody showing up. You know, and on the issues that we work on so much here at the Ruth Institute, things like transgenderism and gay marriage and all of these kinds of issues, a lot of groundwork has been laid. A lot of groundwork has been laid while people are at home, you know, sleeping or, you know, having a normal life, having a normal, what normal people consider a normal life. So that's
I can give you a good example you guys, I'm sure, are involved in, is the effort right now to redefine the meaning of pro-life. I mean, this is a huge thing with groups like, there's actually a whole section of groups, it's not Faithful America, those are pretty left-wing. There's a series of groups, I call them the creation care organizations, if you know that
what?
Term. Creation care. It's more common in evangelical churches than it is in Roman Catholic. Roman Catholic, I think, is the seamless garment, I think is the term.
Oh, yes. Wait, yes. We have the seamless garment over here. Yeah. And creation care, is that like an environmentalist front group or something?
Exactly what it is.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
Well, it's the name of the doctrine they try and push. There's a lot of different organizations like the Evangelical Environmental Network mm-hmm. or the National Religious Partnership for the Environment. There's mm-hmm. some other ones. These things are just as left-wing as Faithful America, et cetera. And they have a lot of the same funders, Hewlett Foundation, Energy Foundation, Soros' Open Society Foundations, but they're different. They don't pretend to be liberal like those groups do, because they're not. They're run by so-called conservative evangelicals, Roman Catholics. But what they're really concerned with is saying, hey, you know, this global warming thing, it's not a left-wing issue. It's not a liberal issue. It's not even a moderate issue. It's an issue for Christians. And so what they'll do is they'll take words like sin and redemption and salvation and forgiveness, but they'll apply them to basically environmental secular concepts. So that mm-hmm. sin is when you pollute because you burn coal and you emit mercury into the atmosphere. That's what sin is now, right? So what happens is the obvious point is to take Christian words, give them new meanings, so that when Christians hear them, they're fooled into thinking, oh, you're one of us. You believe in all this stuff too. You're a Bible believing Christian like I am. And you go along until you're sucked into believing something that you probably would reject if it was, if you were given it at face value. It's very evil. It's very iniquitous. Creation care is the name of that effort to take secular environmentalism and make it sound like Christianity. And if you look at the positions that these groups hold on the environment, on so-called clean air and water and stuff, there is no daylight between them and like the Sierra Club or Greenpeace. A radically secular, radically far left environmental group.
And what's wrong with that specifically, just to be specific about it, is that the Christian view of creation is that we are to be stewards of creation, but that man is good, that we're not in an evil universe, that human beings are not evil. We're not a blight on creation. We're the pinnacle of creation. We have certain responsibilities, but you don't solve your problems by scapegoating the rest of humanity. We're not allowed to do that. We're not supposed to be doing that. And yet we're being sucked into this kind of thing. I see what you mean. Now, so if you're an ordinary Christian in the pews, and the answer probably varies somewhat for exactly where in the Christian spectrum you are, but in general, for the ordinary Christian in the pews, what should they be watching for? What are this thing you just said, this is very important, that they take Christian words and they give them a new meaning, you know, so that's an important tip for people to be on the lookout for. What else can you tell people that they should be watching for that could be sucking them into someplace they don't really want to go?
Yeah, and I am a believer. I'm a Presbyterian. My wife and I go to a Presbyterian church. I'll give you this. We need to learn to interrogate the people who are trying to feed us stuff. Ask, what is your intention with this? What do you hope to gain? How do you stand to gain? And I'm a very suspicious person in that way, because I follow the money. I'm always interested in knowing, where does the money trail lead? When an organization comes into your church, I don't care what kind of church it is, and starts proclaiming things like social justice, this is the biggest issue going on in the church right now.
Right.
Also environmental justice, racial justice, things like that. When they use words that sound like something you're familiar with, like Christians have been talking about justice forever, for 2,000 years, but they slap something on to modify that, you know it's a little different. Question that. Why? What do you stand to gain? I don't mean the person who's telling you that is necessarily trying to mislead you. They may be misled themselves. But ask yourself, if social justice is the same thing as biblical justice, then why isn't it called biblical justice? Why do you have to call it something else? One of the things I like to look at is, what's the left position on any given issue? Because that'll lead you into great insights. There's no daylight between the Marxist-led Black Lives Matter organization's leadership's view of social justice and the kind of social justice that's being pushed right now is biblical theology. There's no daylight. The only difference is the words that are used to describe it. But I don't care what words are used to get you to the thing if the thing is Marxist. If you would look at the thing itself and say, no, that's not found in scripture. That's not consistent with my understanding of the creation and who our God is. You would reject that. So don't be fooled into thinking these things. We need to teach our children that. We need to teach our children that it's not enough to trust in a culturally Christian culture, right, that we have, a Christian culture that we have in the United States, that's dying. We need to be on the alert that when people come trying to sell you things, you need to question these things on both sides and reach a conclusion that's grounded in science in the case of environmentalism, right, but that's also grounded in good biblical theology when it comes to people trying to teach from the pulpit. We have to do these things, otherwise our children will be lost to us and they'll be convinced of these terrible lies, and they'll be led down a very dark road.
Yes, yes. Do you know, one example that keeps coming to my mind when you're talking about this infiltration idea is that in the 60s, when John D. Rockefeller III was trying to promote population control and so on and so forth, one of the things they did was to try to, I would call it corrupt, the Catholic Church, because they knew that the Catholic Church was going to be the biggest holdout, that, you know, their most resistance was going to come from that quarter. So he literally put on conferences at Notre Dame talking about, you know, coming up with a word salad, basically, that has the function that you describe of obscuring what they're really all about. And they'll talk about responsible parenthood and, you know, all these euphemisms to soften up Catholic academics and Catholic clergy for the idea that maybe birth control would really be okay. Maybe we really need it. Maybe there really is a population problem, so on and so forth. It's shocking, actually, how cheaply you can buy an academic. This is what I have always noticed. You know, if you praise them a little bit and give them a little grant money, you know, you can get them to do anything. Well, that's probably a little harsh. But the point is, they knew exactly what they were doing. When Rockefeller went to Notre Dame and put on those conferences in the 60s, he knew exactly what he was doing. You know, he was taking one of the cultural levers in society, namely religious faith, and turning it, you know, and taking advantage of it and trying to turn it towards his purposes. And he's been very successful. I mean, that whole movement has been very successful in corrupting the Catholic Church. We're still dealing with the consequences of it.
Well, and if you go to the roots of the thing, right, you can see where it comes from. And it's why I go back to the population issue and the environmental issue. Yep. They have their roots basically in Marxist thinking. You know, if you have a good biblical worldview of creation, like you laid out earlier, would you ever arrive at the conclusion that human beings are this plague upon the earth, that right. The earth is really good, we're evil and need to be destroyed? Would you ever arrive at that conclusion from the scriptures, right?
No.
From Christian tradition? Of course you wouldn't. So why do these people hold these views? And if the church, if it's suddenly a desperately pressing issue that the earth, that the church needs to take on environmental issues, why is it so starkly at odds with Christian belief for thousands of years? Why is this suddenly something new that we've discovered? We've always lived with the environment. Why is this new? That should make you suspicious. And if you're suspicious, you'll follow the roots back to where the origins of these ideas.
And why are we signing treaties that the Chinese, where we limit ourselves, we don't limit the Chinese production of stuff? What, how does that even work? What's that about? So Hayden, tell us, for the average person in the pew, what is the most surprising thing that you have found in your work researching these different kinds of networks? What have you found that really shocked you that you think people should know?
I've been doing this about 4 years, and I think the single most shocking thing is the scale of it all. I mean, to go back to a group I mentioned earlier, this Arabella Advisors, this big pass-through network, this is a multi-billion-dollar set of organizations. Billions of dollars have flowed through this machine, and exactly nobody on the conservative side basically ever heard of it from 2006 to 2019. I mean, it's shocking that this, the kind of shadowy obscuring going on of this kinds of money movement, and that's just one cog in this huge machine. I found so many networks. One of them, Public Interest Network. Have you ever heard of the public interest research groups? They're on every college campus in America, more or less. They go back to the 1970s. This is another multi-billion dollar network of groups. And all they do is fundraise for other organizations and push all sorts of different policies. And most people are totally unfamiliar with them. And meanwhile, you look at the conservative side and everything's out in the open.
Right.
Very obscure. And it's just, it's interesting to me. I'll tell you this one thing, too, on a more positive note, because I tend to be the bearer of bad news when I tell people how bad things can really be on the other side in politics. You know, the thing is, if you think about it, yes, the scale is massive on the left compared to the right, and yet the bang for the buck is pretty paltry on the left. You barely get a majority in the Congress and barely win the White House. With a president who has absolutely no coattails for anybody else behind him, one of the most controversial presidents in history, right? They have spent billions of dollars to barely pass legislation using all of these outside interest groups. Think of all of the professionals they have to do who are like me. They spend all their time focusing on one issue. There's dozens of me's out there. I'm just one of the few on our side. You know, and they have to have this vast, they have to have basically a government of people just to try and get their way. And even then, they lose more often than they win. Right now, there's so, how much money has been spent, how much ink has been spilled trying to flip the Supreme Court to favor the left. And right now, the conservatives have at least an ostensible majority of three votes. It's shocking to me how often conservatives don't even pay attention to the politics. How little money we spend, how little organization we have in comparison to our opponents, and yet we manage to win as often as we do, shocks me to the bone. That should make people very, That should cheer you up a little bit.
Well, you know, we had the same kind of feeling of in Proposition 8 in California. I was a campaign spokeswoman for Prop 8, and so I was very closely involved in that. And, you know, everybody was against us, and they still couldn't pull it off. And they pulled off all sorts of dirty tricks against us and stuff. And we, you know, they still lost. They had to steal it. They had to steal it through the courts. You know, they couldn't get it through the people, following the people. You know, there's one really puzzling thing that I want to go back to because I want to challenge your use of the word Marxist. But let's get Marx out of our minds for a minute and just notice that there are really, really, really rich people who are promoting this stuff. Now, to my mind, that doesn't sound like the proletariat or anything like that. You know, that just, I just can't make the revolution of the poor thing work for me. To me, this sounds like rich people who want to run the world to their specifications. Modern American democracy is in their way. Private property is in their way. Mm-hmm. Families with a father who's in the home, guarding the family, protecting the family, they're definitely in their way, right? And so, you know, to me, all the ideology just looks like so much noise. The real goal is power, you know? I mean, sometimes we say that the issue is never the issue. The issue is always the revolution. And the revolution is always power, right? So, yeah, we're helping the poor people. Oh, shut up. You are not helping the poor people. You all are helping yourselves. You know, I'm tired. I don't know. Am I off base? Am I getting too cynical in my old age here?
Well, if you are, I am. Because you describe sounds like the Soviet Union or Communist China or Cuba or any other place like that. See, when I use the word Marxist, I understand what you're saying. I'm using it in a little bit different way.
Right.
I'm describing the old Karl Marx way of looking at capitalists versus labor. Mm-hmm. I should actually be better at describing what I do mean. I mean a worldview. I mean a way of dividing all of human history into this one grand story of evil oppressors and the noble poor oppressed. Mm-hmm. Right. You can apply that however you like. Dennis Prager has been very good on this about talking about, and same with Dinesh D'Souza. But right now we're not dealing with people who are talking about proletariat, right?
Right.
Take the sexual revolution. Men are the oppressors, women are the oppressed. Take Black Lives Matter. And not white people are the oppressors. Anybody who's not white is the oppressed. See, when you divide the whole world that way, you show your Marxist training, even if they're not doctrinaire socialists from the 1940s. It's irrelevant. You think like those people do. And when you think like that, the consequence is that they're always looking for power. I agree. It's funny to me that most people, when I do these kind of interviews, they assume that money is always the end goal. And I point out, well, but if you are a billionaire like George Soros, what do you care about money? You're at the end of your life anyway. You've made your billions. What you care about is basically remaking the world in your own image.
Right.
What's the common thread between Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, right? George Soros, Tom Steyer, what, any of these billionaires? The common thread, I think, is that they're like technocrats. They think that they should rule everything, that everybody else, the little person like me or you or anybody else out there, we're incapable of ruling ourselves. We can't make good decisions for ourselves. And so we need these ultra elites who've proven their superiority mm-hmm. to run our lives, to run every aspect of our lives. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not doctrinaire Marxism. That's not really even ideological. That's just, you know, that's just anti-Christian thinking. That's just
right.
what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, these things are a mix. You know, you have Marxist-trained activists, like the leaders of Black Lives Matter. I mentioned this before, but they've said, we are Marxist-trained. And when they say that, they mean the worldview that I just described. They mm-hmm. mean think like Lenin thought. Their goals are different, perhaps, but they thought the same way. And if we don't understand that kind of thinking, we'll lose every time because we'll never understand our opponents.
Do you know what? Here's another thing they all have in common. They have in mind this fantasy ideology, is what I call it, that they have a vision of this world that's going to be so wonderful and so beautiful. But when you get right down to it, all of their fantasies, whatever they might be, whether it's about poverty or the environment or sex or whatever, they're all impossible to achieve, right? Yeah. And so therefore you're accumulating all this power in order to achieve this fantasy, which you can never get. Well, since you'll never get it, you got to have somebody to blame when it doesn't work out. So you have a scapegoat class, right? So you've got your kulaks in Russia, and you've got your Jews in Germany, and you got your Christians here in the United States. It's their fault. It's their fault that our dream couldn't come true, you know. But they hate the world as it actually is. They hate the world of a creator God who created a good world, and that we have a responsibility to use our gifts and talents in a good way. We don't get to do whatever we want just because we can get away with it, you know. And I think that's what makes the rich people madder than anything, is the idea that somebody would, you know, that a little parish priest would tell them, you don't get to sleep with your secretary. You know, that's enough to set them off, you know, that I don't get to do whatever I want. No, you don't. You really don't.
It reminds me of the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11, right? That the Tower of Babel, if you read that story, it sounds really optimistic and hopeful. Oh, great. All the people of the world will get together and basically sing Kumbaya, and we'll build this great tower to the heavens. But what you realize is actually, no, this is actually Satanism, because what they're doing is they're reaching a tower to the heavens so they can dethrone the guy in the heavens and take his place. Right. It's not to be, they want to be gods. And I can't help but think of Proverbs, right? I mean, where the kings of the world, you know, call George Soros the king of the world, but these princes of the world, they array themselves against the Lord, and he simply laughs. Mm-hmm. These are people who their fundamental views are basically at odds with the Christian understanding. And for one thing, if you have no concept of sin, right, you're going to totally misunderstand people. You're going to think that, well, no, we're totally perfectible. We can be perfect. We just need to have enough time. We have to have the right institutions. No. That's not the biblical worldview grounds you in an understanding of, well, you can improve parts of your life. You can improve you to a degree, but don't ever understand that you're going to create some kind of utopia in this
right.
world. You're actually not meant for this world anymore.
Right.
You're meant for the next, for the new creation. And in that sense, you know, it's easy. I spend all my time reading left-wing literature, and it's maybe not very good for me. But I'll tell you this, it's easy to loathe your enemy because the things they say are very hurtful and very wicked, just very iniquitous. But, you know, these are sinners like we are. These are people who they're hurting. They really are lost, and it's pitiable, you know, and it's hard to remember to pray for them very often, but we have to. I mean, these people are as spiteful in the eyes of the Lord as any sin, any unregenerate sinner, unredeemed sinner, I suppose.
Well, you know what? I might get into a big theological thing with it because I don't know what kind of Presbyterian you are. But as a Catholic, I would say Jesus died for them, too. You know, our belief is that Jesus died for everyone, anyone, you know, potentially everyone. It's up to us whether we take it or not. So, you know, this has been a very enlightening conversation. Hayden, I had no idea. Hayden, I keep wanting to call you Franz Joseph. No.
Hayden. Okay.
Hayden, this has been a very enlightening conversation, and I'm sure that our followers are going to be blessed by it, you know, to realize that there's, look beneath the surface, people. You know, there's more going on there than meets the eye. When you see an organization that's got faith in its title, you know, do a little investigation. Don't take these things or these people at face value. So thank you so much for being my guest on the Dr. J Show. And people, take a look at that like button down there below. Take a look at that share button and think about who you want to share this with. I'll bet you have a pastor or a clergyman or religious educator who would really benefit from the conversation that I've had today with my guest, Hayden Ludwig. Thanks so much, Hayden.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.